We've heard four very different presentations that are actually quite interrelated, even though they've started from different points. We have just about 10 minutes for a brief discussion. We can certainly invite the panelists to quiz each other or comment on each other, but if you have questions for them, now is a good time if you want to think more holistically about ways of integrating the different talks. Clearly, there's a lot that is going on in the ocean, in our understanding of the ocean, understanding the dynamic changes that are underway, how we depend on the ocean, how we're using it. But the intersection of those changes is both scientifically exciting as well as really relevant to the quality of life for people around the world. So, Bonnie, would you like to get us started?
Very exciting set of presentations. Recently, I was at an Ocean Studies Board meeting and at the National Research Council, and I was really surprised. There was some discussion of the fact, apparent fact, that at least some members of Congress have talking about the geosciences, which includes oceanography and, you know, in fisheries, biological oceanography, and so forth, and the social sciences are considered soft sciences. And it seems to me that, this has been reflected in real threats to funding for much of the work that you are all doing and others are doing about the oceans. And I guess I'm sharing my shock at this because. But it's also kind of heartening to know that we social scientists aren't the only ones getting this sort of treatment from Congress. But really, what can we do? I mean, it's very clear from the work that you're describing that by any measure, this science is as hard as anything, and it's hard to do, and it requires really, really hard discipline. It requires hard funding. It requires quantitative as well as qualitative information. So I guess I'm just having a plea that we find a way to redress this misinterpretation, from my opinion, of what we're all about.
Any responses, panelists?
Well, I mean, this does seem to me to be an incredibly important communications problem, which is really there are audiences that need to hear what the value that these different fields are bringing to the table. And so these kinds of events, I think, are quite helpful in that. But this is something that's on all of our shoulders in terms of raising the visibility of the net benefits that come from really understanding these systems better and how we interact with them and what a crucial role that they all play for people in so many different ways.
Alan, are you waiting in line?
Yes. So building in some sense on that and the last two talks in particular, that there was an emphasis on economics, but you raised issues like food preferences or getting over a hump that has an economic problem. And even if you were to pay fishermen, you're asking for lifestyle changes over time. Have you been exploring more the integrating other aspects of social science and other social sciences, because this is a problem that is going to not be solved by just, I'm sure that the moderator too would comment about the difficulties of getting policies adopted.
I'd be happy to comment on that. Is this thing on?
Yep. Okay.
Thanks, Alan. That was an interesting question. Our group has been doing some of that. We've been working with some sociologists, anthropologists, and behavioral economists, thinking about sort of getting out into the field and doing, you know, economists get very excited when we get to get our feet wet and stuff like that. And when we say get out into the field, usually what it means is you go somewhere and you're in a lab, you're in a classroom giving people incentives and looking what they do. But that is one of the things we've done, is work with fishing communities and work with governments on designing different approaches for, you know, learning what the uptake would be of different kinds of incentives. So, you know, for example, do fishermen get excited about the idea of getting paid to do science and instead of going fishing that day. And that's just a kind of a small scale example, but there's a lot of these sort of behavioral experiments that can be done to learn about people's preferences and what they're willing to do to change.
Yeah, and I just add that we've started doing a variety of thinking along these lines as we've been doing this food analysis, because behavior change is very hard. I mean, if you're really going to think about how you would actually change, move that dial at all in terms of global preferences, it's really hard to imagine very many things that do it. One of them will be economic preferences, right? And so to some extent, things like pricing in some of these environmental costs into the price of the product will help move things to the right in those curves. In addition to, that's going to have limits in terms of how far you might go. I actually think, from the standpoint of behavior change, the findings that have come out recently in terms of the impacts of these diet shifts onto human health are far more likely to have behavior change than any of the environmental things that I talked about, despite the fact that they are enormous impacts. And so thinking about how you can utilize the shared benefits that come from some of these kinds of changes in things that might be much easier to utilize a variety of different kinds of tools to drive behavior change, you could drive environmental benefits, even though that's not the direct way that you're going after it.
I'd like to comment that a lot of the work that we've been doing has management implications, both for things like the fishery and then for the U.S. Navy. And we found a really great benefit to partnering with those stakeholders so that they're part of the process. They can believe in the science that's been done, see the value, and understand the implications. But that means a lot of communication along the way so that you're not telling them at the end, here's what we say you should do, but instead saying, here's what we found together. And what do you think it means? And making that a joint process that is a lot more effective than a heavy-handed afterthought. But that is at a much smaller scale than sort of global problems that you were asking about.
Yes?
In thinking about the potentials of aquaculture, it wasn't clear to me that you were considering also freshwater aquaculture. So, for example, if all the increase in productivity was tilapia, what environmental effect would that have? And how would that change your conclusion?
Yeah, it's a very good question. We have included freshwater analysis in our analysis, freshwater aquaculture in our analysis. I didn't put up any of that here. This was all just focusing on the ocean side. They are comparable to marine aquaculture in every metric except freshwater. And then it's a matter of how do you account for the altered pollution effects that happen of growing it in a flowing or a lake-bound system. And so there are some issues that are going on right now in terms of coming. We're trying to figure out what's the best way to deal with that kind of thing. But from the other ones, from the greenhouse gas emissions, area used, and nutrient loading of the environment, they're significantly lower than land-based meat production.
I'm going to invite each of the panelists to respond to one of two different questions. Chris, I'm going to start with you. Just work down the way. The first question is, listening to the other presentations this morning, what did you learn that you found to be particularly interesting that is relevant to the work that you're doing? Second option, given all that you told us about the cool new stuff underway, what's the next big horizon for you in the work that you are doing?
I only get to answer one? Geez, Jane.
Well, we'll go through, and if there's time, we can come back.
All right, I'll answer the first one, although I already sort of answered the second one during my talk. Kelly's talk I found very, very interesting, this idea that, you know, you can't survive on the average. And from an economists think a lot about that kind of a problem in risk aversion and portfolio theory and that sort of thing. And it led me to a question that I was going to ask her later, but I'll ask her now, which is, you know, does that suggest that if climate change makes the world more variable, that the world is a better, you know, these species will be better off in a more variable world? And I think that's an intellectually exciting idea to think about.
So you actually want me to answer?
I don't know. Maybe over lunch.
I think I'll give you the short answer, and I think it depends on scale. We are talking about variability at the scale of, you know, tens to hundreds of meters, not over the global scale, and I think that's a really interesting question, is where is that variability occurring? It matters a lot.
So not just patch versus unpatchy, but the scale of the patches.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So I was really excited to think about, as an ecologist and studying behavior, we think a lot about economic theory and frame a lot of the questions that we're asking in that theory. It's provided a lot of influence in my own work. And so I was particularly excited to think about how we might be able to transfer the information we're learning about animals to how we're learning about humans, sort of related to your question about fishing practices and how we might converge that as we think about how we manage that overlap between fisheries and predators. So I was excited to think about how we might take that, where we might be able to take that together.
Fiamma?
My turn. Okay. I'm going to build on all three talks. I think one of the most exciting things for me was seeing really hard science being done, being turned into a positive message. This is science at its best, where we've learned something that we can then apply towards more sustainable living. And I think it was really exciting because it was in all three of your talks. And going back to the communications point that was raised earlier, I think we really as scientists need to learn how to turn some of our messages into a positive contribution to society and really engage the public by showing, or the policymakers, both, by showing the constructive way forward. And I think science does that at its best, always. We just have to remind ourselves to do that.
I would say that, I mean, if in fact you were gonna go down a path where you were trying to enhance the role that aquaculture plays, one of the things that you would really wanna do is take advantage of the fact that we can get out front and plan effectively in terms of where you would put this. And it struck me that both of the first two talks actually dealt with issues that are incredibly important in terms of thinking about the kind of spatial planning that we'd want to put in play for thinking about new ocean uses, whether it's aquaculture or other forms of ocean uses. And they have to do with the spatial variability and the, you know, there's impacts in terms, as we already heard, in terms of where the military base was. Well, let's take advantage of that in terms of if we're going to put new areas into food production, how do you choose places that are going to have lower overall impacts? In the same way that, in a broader way, I think the details of climate change are really going to matter in terms of thinking through how we deal with this kind of adaptation problem, that the parts that we've addressed so far are the simple parts, but there may be also, in terms of the spatial planning aspect, ways that we can identify places that are going to have smaller climate change challenges to deal with from the standpoint of these kinds of expanding uses.
So I mentioned in my earlier remarks that I serve as the U.S. Science Envoy for the ocean, and I've had an opportunity over the last couple of years to travel fairly extensively to a number of developing countries focused on doing science diplomacy around ocean issues. And it's crystal clear to me that there is intense interest on the part of many, many developing countries, small, large, tropical, temperate, in what is being called the blue economy. More and more nations are looking to the ocean as a source of economic development, poverty alleviation, job creation, food security. And they're quite cognizant of the looming challenges of climate change, less so ocean acidification, mostly challenges with pollution, in meeting this opportunity to develop the blue economy. The talks that we've heard today, I think, shed really important light on how to advance science in a way that is contributing directly to many of these countries' interests in the future, in their future, and in using oceans in a way that they haven't necessarily before. These are very tangible, real issues for a lot of these countries. And I think the science that is being brought to bear on these problems is really cool because it's not only cutting-edge science, really advancing intellectual frontiers of our knowledge, but it's also immediately relevant to very real-world social challenges. It's relevant to society. And the experiences that we have had in the United States of reforming fishery management, building off the earlier work that Chris and Steve and others have done in this area, that has included very strong legislation to do fishery reform, but enabled by rights-based approaches that has really flipped U.S. fisheries from being decades and decades and decades of overfishing across the board to returning to sustainability and profitability, has provided a stellar example internationally for other countries. It is possible to do some of the changes that we've been hearing about today to reform fisheries. And in the United States, we have gone in 15 years from having 92 stocks of fisheries that were overfished in the year 2000 to 29 in the year 2015. So from 92 to 29 in 15 years is pretty impressive. Equally and more impressively, I think, is the recovery of depleted stocks. Stocks that were collapsed and now have been rebuilt so that they can be refished. And again, in the year 2000, we had zero stocks that had been recovered that could be refished. But by 2015, we now have 39. And so there is hope that is emerging from good science, good policy, good engagement of fishing communities and fishermen in the changes that were needed. And those changes I mentioned earlier were not easy, but I think the fact that it is possible has really provided hope for a number of other countries. So I want to take this opportunity to really shine a spotlight on what we're seeing as more and more science and scientists being engaged in not only understanding our world, but providing solutions to build upon for the future benefit of humanity, as well as really cool new knowledge. And I think the four talks that we've seen today have been very exciting, really interesting presentations. And I hope you will join me in thanking each of these speakers for a spectacular job, but also for doing what they're doing. It really is exciting and important. They're walking the talk, they're modeling it for their students. And I think this is what we need to keep science alive and hopefully address Bonnie's challenge of not only doing good science, but showing how it's relevant and how important it is for the nation and other nations to invest in good science so that we can help address these common challenges. So thank you, speakers. We appreciate you very much, and terrific job. Thanks.